Today is the anniversary of the Sabarimala verdict. So, in solidarity with our brothers and sisters in Kerala who are fighting for their rights to uphold tradition, I would request all of you to express solidarity with them and remember this day, which was not a particularly happy day. Thank you.
What you started, to be very specific, on Twitter, if you're on Twitter, you could help trend the Save Our Sabarimala hashtag, which, you know, the short form is SOS, which is basically a plea for helping out for solidarity for the devotees of Lord Ayyappa.
Good morning, ladies and gentlemen. Today we have amongst us the most vociferous voices on Kashmir, at least across three generations. It's an honor and privilege to chair the session with a star panel of speakers who have varying views on Kashmir and who will give you an idea, a perception about how history has evolved on Kashmir issue. Since the topic here is Jammu and Kashmir erasing a blot in history, I'm going to narrate a short story on history of Kashmir. One of the greatest kings of Kashmir, Lalitaditya, who ruled Kashmir in 8th century, once wanted to shift his capital, Srinagar, to Parihaspura. However, the residents of the city refused to move to Parihaspura. One night, he was so angry, in a drunken stupor, he told his prime minister to set Srinagar city on fire. The prime minister was wise. He took some dummies and he set them on fire at some distance to give an impression that the city was on fire. The king was placated. Next morning, however, he was remorseful. But instantly, he was also glad that the city had not been set on fire. Nobody had been killed. No house was set on fire. Why am I narrating this story? Because I want to ask our panelists today, who set Kashmir on fire in the last 70 years? And has New Delhi, after 70 years, become the prime minister that Lalitaditya had by revoking special status of Kashmir? I will begin with Tavleen Singh, who is the oldest hand on Kashmir here. Tavleen.
Right. You know, I've written a book about the mistakes made by Delhi that set the House of Kashmir on fire. So also, I've covered Kashmir for 40 years, right? So it's older than most of the people on this panel. Now, you know, the one thing that I wanted, the point that I made in the book is that the problem we are facing today has very little to do with the historical problem. The historical problem was created, I want to praise it, by Nehru, wrongly, by, for a start, allowing an Article 370 to be introduced in the first place. No, first going to the UN, then allowing an Article 370 to be introduced in the first place, because actually the instrument of accession of Kashmir is the same as Junagadh, Hyderabad, and you know, I mean, Menon in that wonderful book of his makes this absolutely clear. There was no reason to give Kashmir special status. Right. Then it's mistake after mistake after mistake that set the house on fire. When in 1975, was it 75, the accord with Sheikh Abdullah? Let's not go too much into the history, arresting Sheikh Abdullah, then making the accord with him. To me, that historical problem died in 75 when that accord was signed. And Kashmir was completely peaceful till 83, when Mrs. Gandhi toppled the government of Farooq Abdullah, For no reason. He would have toppled himself. He was not a great chief minister. And he would have... That election was won by Farooq Abdullah because he was Sheikh Abdullah's son. And Sheikh Abdullah had been 18 years in jail. And, you know, he was... It was his election, not Farooq Abdullah's. So I believe that that is when this phase of the Kashmir problem began. Now, when we come to now, we're still setting that house on fire. Because if any of you have read or saw Imran Khan's speech or his interview to Christiane Amanpour, please pay attention to what he's saying and how little Delhi is doing to contradict it. He is saying Delhi is preparing for a massacre. Lie.
So let me interrupt you here, Tavleen. Rahul, you have written extensively on Kashmir. You have reported from Kashmir. Would you agree with Tavleen that it's New Delhi who set Kashmir on fire?
Hi. I think I do. You asked an initial question about who set this fire in Kashmir. I think I'm very clear about this. And I'll explain how. That the 90% of problems that are cropping up in Kashmir right now come from New Delhi. Let's look at what happened in 1989-90. A handful of young men have decided to cross the line of control to get arms training in Pakistan-occupied Kashmir.
Excuse me, sir. You will get your chance to ask a question after we are done with this discussion. I request you to sit for a while. No, please. No, we will hold the question answer session after we are done with the session. You can point out whatever misrepresentation. Let us move on with the discussion. Thank you.
I'm talking about 1988-89, sir, when it was indeed a handful of people. It was less than 100 people who went
Excuse me, sir, you were also told not to be rude. And for a start, you have no evidence, and he does. He's been covering Kashmir. And it was less than 100 people.
I'm a Kashmiri who has spent
40
years in Kashmir.
He's a Kashmiri too.
Sir, can we continue with this discussion? And if you feel there's some problem with it, then you can raise this question. So like I was saying, so handful of people who crossed the line of control to get arms training. And in those days, arms and ammunition were transported from line of control. And the local intelligence agencies were sending report after report to Rajiv Gandhi government, to VP Singh's government, to do something about it. But obviously nothing was done about it. When the first Kashmiri Pandit killing happened on 14th September 1989, a few days later, Mr. Farooq Abdullah, who was then the chief minister, was dancing with a classical dancer in the ruins of Martand, and he was asked whether there is an onset of militancy in Kashmir. He said, absolutely not. These are militants from Punjab who are doing this. We'll take care of this. But of course, just in a matter of few months, we knew what was going to happen. When Ms. Rubaiya Saeed was abducted, the Indian state was asked to bend. It crawled and released five militants belonging to Jammu and Kashmir Liberation Front. The militancy really began from the evening of that December, when hundreds of thousands of people came out on the streets celebrating the freedom of these people. I remember there was a terrorist of Jammu and Kashmir Liberation Front, Sheikh Hamid, who was injured in an encounter with the security forces. And there was a picture which appeared in the Kashmir Times when he was in hospital. There was a synthol talcum powder behind him, and he was just flashing a V sign to the newspapers. 19th January 1990, all hell broke loose for the minority Kashmiri Pandit community when hundreds of thousands of people from the majority community assembled in these mosques and started shouting slogans. they're all terrible slogans. I think most of them you know. Dil mein rakho, Allah ka khauf, haath mein rakho, Kalashnikov, hum kya chahte, azadi, etc., etc. Hundreds of hapless Kashmiri pandits who had a landline in those days, and we must remember this is 1990, the harshest month of winter in Kashmir. There is absolutely no mobile internet. Even the landline density is so little. So everyone who has access to any landline phone is making frantic calls to Mr. Jagmohan, who was just taken over as governor and was in Raj Bhavan in Jammu. They were making phones to North Block, to Home Ministry officials, but nobody came to rescue because the police and civil administration in Jammu and Kashmir in 1990 had collapsed completely. By the time the government of India took action, 400,000 Kashmiri pandits had already left. I'll just keep it short. From mid-90s onwards, I think it was very clear to all the militant groups that this is a war which they will not win. But from mid-90s onwards, they thought, okay, we're not going to win this war. At least let us make some money. That is how the mess really began in New Delhi. When separatists would be brought to New Delhi, given a lot of money, made to do shopping in Khan Market and other places, and then sent back with the promise that they'll fight elections. By intelligence agencies. The mess created. And the mess, till the abrogation of Article 370, has continued. And, you know, we cover Kashmir on a daily basis. Even now, there is no evidence that the government has learned any lessons from its past mistakes.
Aditya, would you agree that it's because of the weak state that we have in New Delhi that we have arrived at this point where we don't see Kashmiri Muslims openly standing up for India in Kashmir today?
Hi. Namaskar to all. I agree with most of the things that my friend Rahul already said, and he said the base really of what's been happening in Kashmir. But I agree to an extent that you know, we have to look inwards as well. Yes, I will broaden a little more that, you know, the root cause of the problem is that we say that Kashmir is a political problem. It isn't. Kashmir is a religious problem. You know, that's what we need to accept. That's the reality. You know, you may try to shut us, you may try to scuttle us, but it is a religious problem. The roots of the problem are Islamist terror, are Islamist jihad, is Pakistan-sponsored terror. And when the likes of Shehla Rashid and the likes of others like her speak out their mind, that Kashmir is burning, there are people being killed, they are being lynched. Where were these people when Kashmiri pandits were lynched? Where were these people when the other minorities of the Kashmir have been lynched continuously? Now that I've set this tone, there's also a necessity right now to look inwards. What Rahul suggested, what Tavleenji also said, what are the intelligence agencies of India really doing? On the eve of Article 370 abrogation, since we've been closely reporting that, I will just re-emphasize what Rahul and Aarti and others had also reported. There was a team A and there was a team B within the government of India. And it's been an internal discussion within the BJP also, as we all know. Some said that we just need to do away with 35A, not 370. Some said both need to be done away with. Some said, okay, let's loosen the grip over these articles. We don't need to openly brandish and openly come out and do away with it. But this was a historical mistake and this had to be done away with. But what's happening today? Most of you know what Khan Market is, but do you know what Gupkar Road is? You know, Gupkar Road is the equivalent of perhaps Khan Market or a Amrita Shergill Mark or a Prithviraj Road in Kashmir. And the past mistakes are being repeated yet again. The same people, and I will not shy away from taking names, the Shehla Rashids of the world are getting the same state protection, are getting the same state sponsorship from New Delhi to in fact lead politics in Kashmir. So will we lead and perhaps look inwards and introspect that are we going the same way yet again after 30 long years of this Islamist terror and New Delhi committing mistakes? Are we going to commit those mistakes yet again and perhaps lead to further Islamist radicalization and perhaps have the same puppets out there instead of a democracy thriving there or the Indian constitution that really should prevail and the same rights and rules should be equally prevalent there as the rest of India? Thank you.
Before I come to Ashish, I am going to bring in Khalid Shah, who works with ORF as a research fellow and who lives in downtown, one of the separatist hotbeds of Kashmir. Khalid, would you agree with Aditya that Kashmir is a religious problem and not a political problem?
Well, I think we should stop looking at Kashmir as a monolith. Is it a religious problem? Yes. It's also a political problem. It's also a sociological problem. It's also an economic problem. When we brand an entire population of 8 million, and perhaps more than that if you go towards Jammu as well, where you have Muslims, as Islamist, I think it's a very problematic way of framing the question. You know, Kashmir Valley, the politics of Kashmir Valley, is more fragmented than any other place. You have 4 or 5 political parties with various shades of political opinion trying to fight elections. Then you have, beyond that, Jamaat-e-Islami. Then you have Hurriyat, which has its own layers of hardline and moderate, as they want to call themselves. I don't think it's right to say that everybody in Kashmir is an Islamist and everybody is radical and everybody is a terrorist. Because if you're saying that, they are basically defeating your own argument, where you are basically saying that the majority of the people are not on that side. And that has been witnessed time and again through various elections which have been held, which have seen a very robust kind of participation. Recently, we haven't. There are reasons for that. But I refuse to believe that entire Kashmir Valley is Islamist. If it had been entirely Islamist, then it would have been an apocalypse by now.
Coming to New Delhi,
I think the root of the problem is New Delhi. You've had election after election rigged, regime after regime changed, and this is an acknowledgement that the Home Minister of the country made on the floor of the Parliament, saying that New Delhi has always taken unilateral decisions on Kashmir. But what did they do? What did he do a month after that speech? Is that once again a unilateral decision was taken where people of Kashmir, or if I may say, people of entire Jammu and Kashmir and Ladakh, were not taken into consideration. Something that was done unilaterally, could that have been done through persuasion and political arguments? Could that have been done through political discussions? If Kashmir is a religious issue, then why was there a need for a political solution on Kashmir, which is revocation of Article 370?
Let me interrupt you here. Ashish, before I get to Aditya, Ashish, would you agree that there is a gray zone in Kashmir? There is a huge moderate constituency in the valley, which has remained silent, which hasn't really spoken up in the last 30 years because of fear of violence from both sides, India and Pakistan.
Absolutely, but there is nothing surprising about that fact. In fact, any society is composed of what you would call the moderate majority. But I think when we look at Kashmir or any other such problem which involves extremism and violence and intolerance, we have to apply what is called the minority rule here, which means that the most intolerant minority wins. In any given circumstance, let's say, you know, my family, for example, is a Kashmiri Hindu family, and we are all non-vegetarian. But my wife one day decides that she is going to be a vegetarian, and from then on we are having mostly vegetarian cuisine. So because she was intransigent and she decided that she has to have vegetarian, so the rest of us complied, and which is the same case in any society. You know, someone asked, there's this historian, Peter Fritsch or something, I don't get the name correctly, when he was asked about why the Polish people, why did they not protect the Jews? And he eloquently described the situation, that he said that, you know, there were a lot of Polish people who actually wanted to protect Jews, but it would take perhaps a cooperation of 12 good people to protect one Jew, while it would take just one rogue or one bad person to give away 12 Jews. So that asymmetry is at work even in Kashmir. And we'll have to realize that these are all strawman arguments. When we say that, you know, there are majority of the people are moderate. Yeah, yes, of course, we have family friends who are Kashmiris, who are moderate. We still continue to have good relationships with them. But unfortunately, the minority rule applies, and it is always going to be like that. And unless we take that thing in cognizance and we take that head on and have some solutions for that.
I want to actually engage with you on what you just said about how the minority wins. And I also want to take up this, you know, if you think that Kashmir is just a religious problem, we are really on dangerous ground, okay? Now, what do you think Punjab was? Excuse me, I'm a Sikh, and I covered Punjab at the same time as I covered Kashmir. A handful of Sikhs, right, were with Bhindranwale. And what did you do? You maligned the entire Sikh community who defended the Kashmiri Pandits when they couldn't, you know, look after themselves. And you made everyone in India believe.
When was that? When did?
What?
When did the Sikhs defend Kashmiri Pandits?
Guru Tegh Bahadur.
That's a fake history. I don't see any evidence for that.
What?
There is no evidence.
The reason why he was killed.
That's a legend, but that's not.
I'm sorry. Please read a little bit more Sikh history, but forget that. You're distracting from the main issue. Kashmir is a political problem, just as Punjab was a political problem. And when you malign an entire community, as Khalid rightly said, you are going to encourage the government of India to make an even stupider mistake than they've already made, which is to do what they've done without any plan to win the peace. Okay? I actually think Article 370 should go, but what I see is yet another mistake, probably the most serious.
Well, I think what Ashish says is that the minority wins, but you have to also see that there was an enforced silence of Kashmiri Muslims themselves by the terrorists. I've grown up hearing stories where National Conference workers had to give ads in newspapers who were National Conference workers were considered to be on pro-India because they contested elections, saying that Khuda Rasool ke kasam hame National Conference se koi vaasta nahi hai. And there were ads filled with these, newspapers filled with these ads because they had a fear of killing and reprisal attacks. While Kashmiri Pandits were being killed, and this is by no stretch of imagination a comparison of pain, is that there was other side of the community which was also being killed. The Vice Chancellor of Kashmir University, Maulana Masoodi, perhaps the tallest leader of Kashmir. And this, in my opinion, was deliberately being done to enforce a silence and compliance of majority towards a very virulent kind of politics. And that, in my opinion, is what even today is leading to a spiral of silence. Nobody today wants to come out and put his neck on the fire and get killed. And people have been killed and people are still being killed. And we don't know who's on which side in this debate. You know, you talk about New Delhi. We don't know who's going to make a deal with New Delhi tomorrow and turn into an antagonist and start coming after whoever they see as a moderate voice.
Arti, sorry for barging in. Just one interruption. I have often heard this story which Tavleen says, oh, you know, it's only one small group of people. Tavleen did Punjab much more than I would have ever done, or I could have. I was way too junior. And Khalid just now mentioned that NC people had to issue ads. But if only a small minority was so horrible, why did the majority have to issue ads?
Well, it's simple. Power comes through the barrel of gun. You had an entire collapse of the state machinery in J&K. It was total anarchy in 90s. And it is reported and documented.
You know, I have a serious problem. I'll just make a small interjection. I have a serious problem with this thought process and this kind of a mindset that has been erupting since August 5th decision that, you know, these 8 million people who are only Muslim in Kashmir are being subjected to torture, they're being killed, and you know, you are branding this entire population into Islamists, and these are radicals.
I didn't say torture. I didn't use the word torture. No.
Khalid, let me
complete. No. I said you have to take people into consideration.
You know, Muhammad Ayub Pandit, who was lynched 2 years ago outside the main mosque of...
I know, I have reported that story with you, Aditya.
...was not an Islamist.
I have reported that story with you, Aditya, but I was not talking about torture.
On August, was not an Islamist. So we need to realize that there's a large chunk of silent majority that will speak up now. They have their rights. They have now been given power. It's not an easy battle. It's going to be a long haul. But certainly, I see that they are not Islamist. There is a silent majority out there, and we need to back them.
No, there are.
Thank you.
No, I would like to respond to what Khalid said. Of course, it's a fact that... when Kashmiri Pandits were brutally killed in their houses, in offices, or on streets. There were also some people among the majority community who were being killed by the same terrorists. But, you know, I was there. I was 13, 14 years old when it was all unfolding in front of my eyes. And from that experience, from that lived experience, I'm not ready to give a clean chit to the majority community in Kashmir. I'll say why, I'll explain why. On the night of 19 January, hundreds and thousands of people, when the number of militants was maybe 200, 300, 400, 500, 60 lakh people in among Kashmiri Muslims in the valley in 1990. Hundreds of thousands of them in mosques saying slogans like, and I would like to put this on record as I always do, in Kashmiri, Asigas Pannui Pakistan Bhatta Rusti Bhatnansan, which means we want our Pakistan without Hindu men, but with their women. And this was going across all mosques in Kashmir Valley. I have personally witnessed processions of about 700,000 people on the streets of Kashmir, wearing shrouds, hurling expletives at Kashmiri Pandit girls in Srinagar. We have records of Kashmiri Pandit doctors, engineers, professors being killed. I was just speaking to a young woman who works with Economic Times now. Her grandfather was 52 and he was a revenue officer. The man was led by his close friend and abducted, and his body was found hanging the next day, riddled with bullet marks. We know the story of the young telecommunication engineer B.K. Ganju, who was killed in a rice drum because a neighbor in old Srinagar pointed out his whereabouts to militants, Bitta Karate. We know what happened to Naveen Sapru. As he was being shot, there was a macabre dance of people around him. Okay, let's for a minute say that you know, there was pressure on Kashmiri Muslims also. But what about now? For 30 years, I think the biggest betrayal for us personally than the exodus is this complete denial of the circumstances that led to the exodus of Kashmiri Pandits. You speak to I'll just take 30 seconds. You speak to any Kashmiri Muslim, even in most of private conversations, you speak to a taxi driver, you speak to a professor, अरे आपको तो बड़ी गलती हो गई, बहुत गलती हो गई साहब, आपको तो जगमोहन ने निकाला. अरे who was Jagmohan? Jagmohan was not there on the night of 19 January when this whole situation was unfolding. Jagmohan issued an open statement, an appeal to the Kashmiri Pandits on 23rd March 1990 that please do not leave Kashmir. We'll set up temporary camps for you within Badami Bagh cantonment. But every person takes a call depending on his or her threat perception. When my father's friends were killed, how could he stay back? We had to leave. Jagmohan was not any Pied Piper of Hamelin that he would play his flute and all Kashmiri Pandits would leave their home and hearth. It's just not possible.
Let me put this question to Ashish. Ashish, in the last 2 months, there has been a partial lockdown in Kashmir because of disconnectivity in mobile and internet. And we also know that one shopkeeper, 65-year-old shopkeeper, was shot dead by militants because he opened his shop during this lockdown. We also know there was another family of four who were shot at by militants for restoring their business. Wouldn't you give some leeway, some concession to the majority in Kashmir that they are also under threat? After all, 15,000 Kashmiri civilians have been killed by militants for defying them, for disagreeing with them, for opposing the call for Azadi and separatism. Wouldn't you give some concession to the majority?
Aarti, I've already given that concession, but I think that, you know, I am speaking more impartially, and I am not really interested in, you know, pinning a moral blame on X or Y section of the society. What I'm interested in is the dynamics of a society, and these are more or less impersonal forces at play. And when I say that the minority rule applies in Kashmir, it is a rule that will apply regardless of the moral character of the people involved. The intransigent minority wins, and that is the case in Kashmir. Now, that I just want to add to what Aditya says about the religious nature of the problem. Religion and civilization are interchangeable terms in terms of when we talk in the Indian context. And therefore, you know, I think most of the media and most of the conversations on Kashmir are skewed because they are framed incorrectly, and they are framed in what I would call the milieu of a narrative fallacy. Why? Because we are trying to find explanations to the problems, and we are so obsessed with, you know, addressing this cognitive itch about explaining what is going on in Kashmir, which is such a complex problem, that we look for small things like, oh, Farooq Abdullah wahan nahi tha, oh, Mufti Muhammad Saeed ka ye ho gaya, wo ho gaya. And these are all problems of real politics. You know, that even today, as you said, there are so many mistakes being made. That is all fine. That will always go. That is the nature of politics. But if we don't look at it in a civilizational perspective, in terms of the change in demography that has been happening for the last 500 years, I think we are missing the elephant in the room. And that is that I completely agree with Aditya that it is a religious problem. And unless we look at it in terms of that 500-year history of how the community has been persecuted and how the demographics have been changing, I think we are missing the bus.
Khalid and Tavleen, I'm going to look, in 2016, Hizbul Mujahideen commander Burhan Wani was killed. The entire valley voluntarily chose a lockdown. There were protests, almost 80, 90 youth were killed in clashes with security forces. This was a Hizbul Mujahideen terrorist. It wasn't a civilian killing. And yet, the entire valley came out with a strong expression in favor of a Hizbul Mujahideen terrorist, the same group that threw out Kashmiri Pandits from the valley. And yet, today we are seeing a different dynamic in Kashmir, almost on the same pattern, you know, as 2016.
Well, if you look at 2016, you have to also look at the context. You have to look at 2014. The same people would have been a part of election rallies. There was a 60 to 70% participation in elections and assembly elections in 2014. And it is true for Kashmir that, as Bakshi Sahab once said, he was asked, how many people do you have with me? He said, 40 lakh. He said, how many do you think are with Sheikh Abdullah? He said, 40 lakh. He said, what is the population of Kashmir? He said, 40 lakh. He said, then how do you explain it? He said, Kashmiri mein bharosa nahi hai. Aaj ek side hoga, dusre din us side hoga. I'll give you another anecdote. Something that I personally saw. There was a rally that Saeed Ali Shah Gilani organized in somewhere in Pulwama in South Kashmir, I think somewhere around 2014, in which a lot of people came up, thousands of people came up. In the same ground, there was a rally organized by Mehbooba Mufti, where again thousands of people turned up. There was a third rally which was organized by the CRPF. It was a CRPF public Mela. Guess which one had the biggest crowd? The CRPF Mela. So you can never decide which side the Kashmiri tide is going to turn, because here it's something very psychological, because Kashmiri as a collective expression, even as an individual expression, has been very ambivalent. We refuse to take sides and take sides once forever, because what then explains that immediately after 2008 elections, you have 2008 protests, and 2010 you have massive participation in elections.
Let's not pretend that it isn't a religious problem now, okay? Burhan Wani, you know, 1 minute. Burhan Wani was asking for the Shariat to be imposed.
Of course, I know.
No Azadi.
I've written about it. I know.
All right. So what we are dealing with at the moment is a religious problem, but it wasn't always. It was a political problem that today is a religious problem. But I think we should come to the present. Look at what they, how are we handling it? You have got, you know, no way, at the UN, where is the government of India's case? you know, the lies that Imran Khan has told at the UN. He has said there are, you know, 900,000 troops, that 80 million people are in jail. And where is the government of India's position? I haven't heard it. You know, I don't know who has.
Khalid, someone would might say that it is the way Kashmiri character, the way Kashmiri responses change. It's probably because they have learnt the art of blackmailing. Blackmailing New Delhi for the last 70 years. That if you don't do this, we are going. If you don't do that, we are going. Essentially, a mechanism with which they have extracted as much as they could from Delhi and gotten away with everything.
Well, I don't know if it's a blackmail or not, but it's certainly a outcome of misguided policies of New Delhi. You know, recently when the parliament election happened, there was an independent candidate somewhere in North Kashmir. If you look at the voting record as to who voted for him and how he got funds and where he got the funds from, you will understand that it's not the Kashmiri. Sometimes it's the other way around. Is that there is a inherent, there is some kind of a tick which with intelligence people who have a tenacity of propping up all kinds of dark horses. And thus, when you do that, you know, it's like the most...
So Khalid, you're essentially saying that revocation of special status, what I gather from what you have said so far, revocation of special status is a mistake. It's unconstitutional and it's undemocratic.
No, I didn't use the word unconstitutional. I neither use the word mistake. But what
unilateral decision
without taking the people into consideration, definitely yes. It's a gross disempowerment of the people. You've turned a state into a union territory and you're celebrating it. Where in the democracy does this happen? This downgradation of a state into union territory, I think, is a big disempowerment. It's not a disempowerment of people of Kashmir. It's a disempowerment of Jammu. It's a disempowerment of Kashmir. It's a disempowerment of anybody who wants their rights and make laws.
I wonder why the people of Jammu were celebrating.
Yeah, well, you have to make them understand. I'll answer that. I think they're utterly stupid to celebrate it.
Well, that's...
Of course, you know, it is. A state has been downgraded into a union territory.
Condescending would be an understatement there.
It's not. If you had any idea of political science and how the rights of people work, look at Delhi. It's wanting a statehood.
Yeah, look, one small point that I would like to make here is that, we are talking about, again, whether the state should have done this, whether they should have done that. I don't know why the state doesn't have this problem in Andhra Pradesh or in Maharashtra. The fact is that it is a glaring demographic problem. And as long as the state looks the other way and thinks that, Kashmir is just like any other state, the problem is Kashmir is a Muslim majority state and that is why there is this problem.
See, again, you're making the mistake of seeing it as a monolithic Muslim majority. It's not a monolithic Muslim majority.
I didn't use the word
Gujars,
monolithic
there are
or polymathic.
Bakarwals, there are Kashmiris.
Of course there are.
There are fragmentations within a society which go beyond religion, which go beyond identity and language.
Even in Andhra Pradesh.
The problem is that when you start seeing an entire population as a monolith,
I am not seeing
you are
it
defeating
that way.
Your own argument.
I am not seeing it that way. It's all I am saying is that even Andhra Pradesh has different sects and different castes and different...
You're confused. I think there's a paradox in your mind. The paradox is that you see the Muslim majority character of Jammu and Kashmir as
you're putting words in my mouth. I'm not looking at it as a monolith.
You ask General Saab, he'll tell you the Muslims of Jammu...
Why should I ask General Saab? I'm a Kashmiri. I know the society.
Okay, let me explain it to you why you're wrong.
Yeah, Aditya.
On a very lighter note, I'll just sum this up in a very, small, what the reality is, which we often speak off record, but not on reality. The problem of Kashmir is that a typical Kashmiri politician, I'm not branding all of them, receive money from Islamabad and receive money from New Delhi. But till now, they used to receive money from both sides, but work only for Islamabad. Now, finally after August 5th, they will have to choose one side. And that's the reality of the situation. Now, we've discussed for the last 45 minutes, just one point that I want to make, is that nobody's bothered about the Valmiki Samaj and the Dalits of Jammu and Kashmir. You know, I have tears in my eyes, and I'm so emotional about them, that for all these years, for all these decades, their sons and daughters would only be sweepers. I mean, in the India of 2019, you have Dalits of Jammu and Kashmir who do not have the same rights as the Dalits of rest of India. They can only apply in J&K government only as sweepers. The women of Jammu and Kashmir cannot buy property if they marry anybody from Rome or Tokyo or, for that matter, from Bangalore or Kerala. That's the reality that the Umar Abdullahs and the Mehbooba Muftis of the world will not speak about.
I agree with Rahul. Aditya. I agree with Aditya on both points. The first point, that they would take money from both sides and work for only one side. I think the one side must have been very stupid for them to let do this. Second, about the discrimination, yes, there was discrimination. There is an admission of that. But I'm not saying that discrimination should not have been whittled away. And I'm glad that it has been whittled away. When I read about this, how Valmiki Samaj was brought in from Punjab and how their rights were denied, I was like, what is this? This is bizarre. And I think this Kashmiri chauvinism, which was with the political class in Kashmir, I think that has in a way led to what we have seen today.
You know, when someone asked me to explain the world of counterinsurgency in Kashmir, you know, I give them this reference. You know, there's a 1982 film, I think, a film called Utsav, directed by Girish Karnad. It's loosely based on the Sanskrit play Mrichikatika. And it's not based on it. Okay. So there's a scene where Vatsayana, played by Amjad Khan, you know, he's trying to document Kama Sutra along with his assistant. And they go to various places, to brothels, etc., to record various acts of sexual intercourse. During one of such records, the assistant has climbed upon a room, and he's looking down into a room to record a supposed act of sexual intercourse. But what he's actually looking at is a thief played by Anu Malik, I think, who is trying to climb up a row of curtains. And when the assistant gets down, Vatsayana asks him, so what did you see? The assistant says in Hindi, he says, "Ye mano kalpana se pare hai. This is beyond human imagination." So the world of counterinsurgency in Kashmir is beyond human imagination. You know, we talked about how most of these separatist groups and individuals in Kashmir are getting money from both New Delhi and Islamabad. I would disagree with Aditya. I think I have absolutely no record right now to see any perceptible change in things to come, that, you know, these guys will not receive any money in future for these. Let's also look at a couple of things. I think there is a significant number of people in Kashmir Valley today among the majority community. We should look at, you know, there are 10% Shias in Kashmir Valley. There are 80,000 policemen. Many of them have died in the line of duty for the idea of India. Many among the Kashmiri Sunni population, they may not have any inherent love for the idea of India, but they are wise enough to understand that their future lies with the idea of India. And for once, you know, they want to come out and speak openly in favor of India. But they are not able to. When Mr. Modi's government came out in 2014, they thought that here is a Hindu nationalist government, ultra-nationalist government.
I noticed,
you know, they'll do something about
Rahul,
it.
I noticed,
but the first thing they do is make an alliance with the PDP.
I noticed from the left
go back
to the right of this political spectrum, everyone is blaming government of India. Everyone is blaming Indian intelligence agencies. No one is, however, putting a spotlight on Pakistan. And when Tavleen says that it used to be Kashmir was a political problem, but it is now converted into a religious problem, I want to ask, what was two-nation theory? What was 1947? What was the ground for which Jammu and Kashmir feels that it should be part of Pakistan or it should secede from India? Is that political in nature or is that religious in nature? My question to all the panelists here. Khalid, you can start.
Well, the partition, as you're saying, was on the religious lines, yes. But in Indian case, I don't think the theory of partition applies because India is a secular democratic republic. You have more, a bigger population of Muslims here in India than you have in Pakistan, number one. And number two is that Kashmir was an exception to that because there was a Muslim majority state which acceded to India, and the most popular leader of that time, which was Sheikh Abdullah, Kashmiri Muslim, was in favor of accession. So that exception has been made.
Khalid, keep it short. Just in one line.
That exception has been made to the partition. We are not a part of the partition theory. We have rejected it.
Okay, that's what I'm saying. The fundamental mistake was that Kashmir acceded because it had 2 months of independence and was invaded by Pakistan. And the Hindu Maharaja realized that there was nothing to do but accede to India. Now, you know, partition was religious, but this was political.
I think I just want to make a brief comment about future now. You know, for the last 70 years, whenever people in mainland India have spoken about Kashmir's accession to India in 1947, you know, their emotion, their sentiment is as if India should be thankful to Kashmiris for acceding to India in 1947. I think the time has now come for Kashmiris to be thankful about the fact that they are a part of India.
We will now open the floor for questions. Please raise your hand. Abhijit first.
So, you know, it's all fine looking back at the past. My issue right now is what happens next. Because I know there's disagreement on the panel. I personally am one of those people that believe 370 going was a good thing. But what we're seeing now is more of the same. There's recycling. There's a lot of hints that the old discredited politicians are going to be recycled. We still don't have a solution to the fact that Pakistan holds all the
sticks. So your question is basically future. What is the future now?
Two specific things. One is the recycling of old politicians. And the second, like Khalid said, they take money from both sides. Or sorry, Aditya said, they take money from both sides, but they only serve one. Pakistan has all the sticks. If you talk against Pakistan, they will have you killed by militants. India, if you spit on India's face, they'll give you money to keep you quiet. Right, so India's all the carrots, Pakistan's all the sticks. Where are any of you seeing any kind of change in governmental policy? Because 370 or no 370, if this is going to be the continuous policy, then we're down.
So question, the question is future road. And the old politics.
You know, unfortunately, Abhijit, as you know as well, and as I mentioned, Gupkar wrote, the policies are unfortunately going to be the same. Yes, I mentioned about, you know, what happened, you know, just a few days back. But I want to give you two examples. One of Engineer Rashid, you know, a very popular figure, provocative figure, who, again, you know, we talk about, Rahul and others have reported, apparently have taken money from Islamabad and New Delhi both. He's under arrest right now. He was being interrogated by the NIA. On the eve of his arrest, he called a top army commander and said, sir, while crying, he says that ab meri Amit Shah ji se deal kara dijiye. Main North Kashmir mein 4 se 8 seate aapke liye leke aa jaunga. So this is the changing trend that, you know, he wants to really submit completely and surrender. But the reality remains that the intelligence agencies are still in power. And again, I will not shy away from taking names. The AS Dulat model is still prevalent in Kashmir, unfortunately. And the main problem out there is this AS Dulat model is still surviving. While one of the teams did, you know, win on August 5th, but that second team, the Team B, is still ruling out there from Gupkar Road.
Before, Khalid?
You know, Abhijit, I think a political process has to revive, which means that politics has to come back. Now, there are two options. One is to recycle the old politicians and let them do the politics they want to do. The second is to allow a grounds-up political movement to happen. But that comes at a very, that comes at a risk, and that can come at a very heavy price, because you don't know which way the pendulum of violence is going to swing.
Yeah.
Ashish
is going to respond.
Yeah, so I find it personally prudent to make a distinction between the Indian state and the Indian civilization. Indian state is the state machinery, and Indian civilization are people sitting here, including all of us. And when we look at, I mean, I think media, being part of the media, people tend to get into an advisory mode to the government. You see, the problem is that the government does things because it is compelled to do things in a certain way because it has a certain character. And if, as someone with a skin in the game in the Indian civilization, I would say that it is important to look at the Kashmir issue in a wider perspective and understand the underpinning, the relationships between, let's say, the Sabarimala issue, the demographic issue of India, the free speech, and everything else.
Ashish.
And just one last point. And unless the Indian state is open about its civilizational duties, I think the Kashmir problem will never be solved.
You passed a generic judgment on the entire India, entire media of India.
I'm just saying there is a tendency.
So let's not get there. I'm going to let somebody ask the question from the audience. This gentleman. The one, yeah. You.
I have the mic.
Oh, you have the mic? All right, go ahead.
So is the Chinese solution to Tibet the right thing to do? Is it right constitutionally, morally, or should it be done at all?
No. I mean, we are a very different country from China, sir, and we should continue. No. It's not. Like Khalid said, whatever the state thought deemed fit to do, it has done. But now is the time to remove this clampdown and lockdown. It has gone for very long. Ordinary Kashmiris are suffering, and it is. It is not helping India's cause in Kashmir at all. I think in due course of time, a due political process should begin. But it should begin with a certain template so that the mistakes of past are not repeated again.
Good morning to everyone present here. My name is Manas and I'm from Assam, which has been in turmoil for the past 30 years, as you may have heard. So like Kashmir, there has been a huge demographic change in Assam also. And my question is to both Aditya Rajkol and Rahul Pandita, any one of them may answer. So do you think Assam is going the path of Kashmir in the sense that there's a growing Muslim majority over there and the Hindu minority is increasing day by day? Do you think that Assamese Hindus will face the same problem as the Kashmiri Pandits did? And my follow-up question is to Khalid, Mr. Khalid. How do you feel now that tribal states in the Northeast have certain privileges that Jammu and Kashmir used to have, but they have now been abrogated? Do you feel that the tribal states should still have the privilege, or should they be abrogated too?
Well, not on the lines of Kashmir, but certainly we need to wake up to the situation, not just in Assam, but also places like Kerala and other places where we are facing the same trend, the same kind of radicalization, the same kind of madness, and the madrasas being very much prevalent. We know the reality. So I think it's going to be the same, but we need to understand J&K is a little different because of the external factor as well. There's a Pakistan out there which isn't the same. So we can still realize, we can still wake up and end this entire madness.
Well there's already a call to have some kind of restrictions for purchase of land. I was in Kashmir recently, Valley. And my sense is that people are very insecure about jobs because they think they have to compete with people coming in from outside. And there's already highest unemployment in India is in Jammu and Kashmir. So I think a decision on that front is very important because that insecurity regarding jobs should not translate into something else.
My question is to Mr. Dhar and Mr. Kaul. I had a friend in my college, he was from Kashmir, and when I asked him what the problem is, he's a simple man. He just said, ye Kashmiriyat Kashmiriyat karte rahenge, aur ye problem realize nahin karenge jab tak inke saamne na aa jaye. That is, I want to understand that we have talked a lot about Pakistan state doing this, that. Is there some element people need to introspect from Kashmir, specifically the Pandit community from Kashmir, that they allowed this Kashmiriyat to go far until the impending danger came knocking at their doorstep and they did not realize what hit them, like we are doing currently in the India. And one short remark to Mr. Pandit. I'm sorry, I don't know the name. He said mainland India. Why is it mainland India? I did not like this statement. So we are doing the same thing right now. We are talking about nationalism, secularism, inclusivity, all these big things. But on the ground, it is very different.
I think I've addressed it more or less. We did not allow Kashmiriyat to grow. Kashmiriyat was one of the rhetorical devices used to gloss over the realities of Kashmiri society. And that was pure propaganda. Otherwise, like I said, for the last 500 years, there has been a consistent, measurable demographic decline of the Hindu population in Kashmir, and there is no doubt about what has gone on in the last five centuries. And no one likes to leave their homes of 5,000 years and you know, pay due respect to abstractions like Kashmiriyat. We were victims, we are victims, and I don't think we should be blamed for that.
You know, Kashmiriyat is a misnomer. You know, there's no Kashmiriyat out there. There's no word in the dictionary of Jammu and Kashmir. And this Kashmiriyat ended in 19 January 1990 when Kashmiri Pandits were thrown out. I say this, you know, always, every day of my life. Secondly, you know, there is this horrific situation in Kashmir. The so-called Kashmiriyat that's being pointed out is if a Kashmiri Pandit, old man living alone in a farthest corner of South Kashmir dies, then there are Muslims doing the funeral. Is this Kashmiriyat? Is this how you will preach to the world that there is secular credentials to this horrific Azadi movement?
Hi, there's a view that the Kingdom of Jammu and Kashmir consisted of different parts, which were different from each other because of religious, ethnic, and political dynamics. It was only held together because of the autocratic Dogra military rule. So what we see today is that a natural thing which should have happened long before, that a reorganization of the state, that the partition, Ladakh, Jammu Valley, Mirpuri area, which is Pakistan and Gilgit. So I just want to understand the historical dynamics, and do you see this is a natural way that things are playing out, that you have a reorganization of the state?
The state as it is now came into being in 1846, I think, and it was there was no binding force for the state to be together. But if you're saying that the state has to be reorganized on the basis of ethnic lines, then what are you talking about Gilgit-Baltistan, for instance? Where do you see that area going? Under which ethnic category are you going to club them together? Because they're not like Kashmiris, and we're not like them. Our cultures are different. So there has to be an artificial, what do you call it, of coming together of various regions. It can't be purely on ethnic, religious, and cultural lines.
We are all out of time.
We're running out of time?
Yes.
We have another 5 minutes?
We'll just take one last question.
Okay, one last. Okay, all right.
My question is to Tavleen. I have been to Pakistan 4 times. And I would like to understand from Tavleen her, you know, her interactions with people in Pakistan. And what opinion does she have about this Kashmir struggle in Pakistan?
The Kashmir struggle in Pakistan in POK? I haven't actually understood the question.
I think he's probably saying that what is the view of Islamabad and also POK on Kashmir?
Okay. The problem that Pakistan faces with the 370 going away is actually probably worse than ours, because every Kashmiri child, I mean every Pakistani child in every madrasa and in every school in Pakistan is told that the jugular vein of Pakistan is Kashmir. So that's why Imran Khan is getting so hysterical, because they've been taught that. So ordinary people, when you go there and they talk about their other problems and they'll tell you, trade honi chahiye India ke saath aur hum India jaise hain, but they say, but pehle Kashmir ka masla hal karo. So their problem is really huge, because the generals and their puppet prime minister now really have no answer as to what to do next. They're almost in the same situation as us, actually.
Thank you, Tavleen. Thank you, Khalid, Rahul, Aditya, and Ashish. Thank you, audience, for listening to this complex debate. Thank you. Thanks.
Thank you.